said, I'm Emma and I look after the people team within Red Bull. And I'm just going to take you through how we approach mental health at work. But more specifically, kind of take you guys through, I'm not sure this is working, sorry.
Want the other one?
Yes. So I'll let that kind of work itself out. Have you got the other clicker?
There's one there.
That's the one. Perfect. So more specifically, to take you guys through some external insight and actually how this insight really drives our key focus areas and is really kind of the why behind what it is that we do. And then from that, how that links to kind of our overarching people philosophies, how that drives our UK values. And then I'll just kind of finish off with some inputs into specifically what we're doing if our people at times need more help. Because a lot of the stuff I'll cover are the things that we're kind of doing every day to really enable that engagement piece. So Charmaine kind of took us through some of it, but it'll come as absolutely no surprise to each and every one of you that the workplace is changing. And therefore, we need to adapt in the way that we manage and develop our people, also in the way that we engage our people. And engagement is such a focus area for us. And I think it is for everyone. And when we've always talked about it, it's about how engagement positively correlates with performance and, you know, how it reduces our employee turnover. But there's so much research out there to show that actually if you focus on engagement, it positively correlates with happier and healthier people. And therefore, by understanding what engages our people and doing something about it, that's us supporting mental fitness in the workplace. And not only mental fitness, but physical fitness as well. And we have a high number of millennials, so when we look at some of the Gallup insight, which is fantastic in terms of how millennials like to work and live, if you guys haven't read that report and you have a high number of millennials in your business, definitely recommend you reading it. You can see that emerging workplace expectations are shifting, and millennials continue to disrupt the way we communicate. And where historically people have kind of looked and worked for a paycheck, actually people now are a lot more driven by purpose. Absolutely, compensation has to be fair. Actually, it's about this kind of wider purpose, and where previous generations' purpose tended to be around family and community, we need to understand what each and every person's purpose is. Also, people get engaged by development now. So having these ongoing conversations, we have feedback, instant communication, so readily available with technology, with social media, and people aren't expecting anything differently at work. So having to wait to have a conversation with your manager, having to wait to get feedback, it's just not working. And we need to look at how we can have those ongoing conversations and make sure that people have the best experience as a manager, but that we put the responsibility on the employee as well. Also, I'll kind of come speak about it in a bit more detail. As Charmaine mentioned, it's a lot more around this strengths focus, understanding people know that's where they're growing. But I think the piece of insight that resonated most with us and that probably is most relevant to now is where everyone had always wanted a good job. People now want a good life, and I think we've spoken for the last 10 to 20 years about how we get the perfect work-life balance, and we kind of don't look at it like that. You know, work is your life. You spend so much time there, and therefore we have such a higher sense of well-being, and we want to be engaged behaviourally and emotionally. But less than 40% of people say that they're thriving, or 40% of millennials say that they're thriving at work, and this is exactly the same amount as previous generations. So we've actually been unable to carve better paths when it comes to getting better well-being for future generations. And this is something we fundamentally believe needs to change. So knowing that these things engage people, knowing that engagement enables happier and healthier employees, these six things kind of really do remain our focus. And they link really nicely to our overarching Red Bull philosophy. So these are our philosophies, our people philosophies globally. And they come directly from our founder, Dietrich Mateschitz. And their meaning, freedom and responsibility and mastery. And for those of you who are familiar with Dan Pink's work, in kind of different words, they're kind of really similar. And they're three critical factors that affect motivation. Motivation affects engagement. Engagement affects, yes, performance, lower turnover, but again, well-being. And this meaning piece, again, is something really close to our founder's heart. And he actually attended a lot of lectures at university by a psychiatrist called Viktor Frankl, who some of you may be familiar with. He wrote a fantastic book called Man's Search for Meaning. And he's a Holocaust survivor. And he believed the reason he was able to survive and get out of Auschwitz is because he actually had a meaning to what it is he was doing. And he wrote this book about how you can really surpass all expectation and outperform if you understand your meaning. And I'm gonna really probably butcher a lot of his work now by massively paraphrasing. But in terms of how it links to well-being is, he created this term when he got out called logotherapy. And it's basically, he explains mental health being the gap between what you're doing now and really your meaning and your purpose. and therefore the wider the gap, or if you don't understand your meaning at all, the more likely you are to have a mental health problem, more likely you are to have depression, and also kind of, what's the word I'm looking for, kind of like attachment issues. Whereas actually the closer you are to your purpose, and if you understand your purpose, the more likely you are to be mentally fit. So how we put this into Red Bull is that when everybody starts with us, we want to understand their why. We want to see what their true meaning is and how we can help support with that. So we have certain tools that are provided where, and certain exercises where people can communicate their why, but also we train managers in understanding their people's why and their people's motivator. And as Vic mentioned, you know, we have a really big purpose at Red Bull, and our purpose is to give wings to people and ideas. And the definition of that is to enable, inspire, and challenge people to do more with their time and talent. And that is a pretty good, and we believe, great purpose. Actually, sometimes it's hard for people to connect to that or see that every day. You know, everyone knows the slogan, Red Bull gives wings. What does that mean to our people? And therefore, each and every team does have a workshop where they go through what is it their team does every day that connects to that company purpose, and a step beyond, what is it you do within your team that connects to that wider meaning. Our second philosophy around freedom and responsibility is essentially everyone is an individual. Mind Gym had this stat recently that 61% of people bend themselves out of shape to fit in at work, and that is completely the opposite of what we want our people to do. Everyone is individuals, and therefore we need to give them the freedom to do things in their way. We purposely have a flat structure, and we purposely have a really big job philosophy. We purposely do not have competencies. We understand that each and every person is unique, and when they go into a role, they're going to do it differently to somebody else. And how that kind of manifests itself is a lot of our process is bottom up. People will set their own objectives. They are responsible for their own performance management. So going forward, particularly into 2018, it's not a manager's responsibility to performance manage their people, to have regular reviews, to find out what motivates them. It is absolutely a joint responsibility for each one of our people to say, I want to meet with my manager this often, these are the tools I want to use. And therefore, we don't just have leadership objectives. Every single person within our business has a leadership objective, because with that freedom comes the responsibility, and therefore they're held accountable to that as well. And then our final philosophy, which is kind of the one that a lot of our toolkit sits under, is this mastery, and it's our urge and motivation to want to get better at stuff. And as Charmaine was saying, a lot of companies now are moving towards a strength-based approach, and that is something we absolutely adopt at Red Bull. So where traditional psychology has always tended to focus on what's wrong with people, we want to flip that on its head and look at, what if we studied what's right with people? And for years, we've kind of always had this fixation on identifying, analysing, and correcting weaknesses in order to become strong. And if you think, this kind of dates back to our childhood. We can get our school report, we take it home, we can get A's and B's on kind of everything, but you've got that C in maths. What's kind of the subject that your parents and teachers would tend to focus on? Would be that C? They'd ask you to spend more time on something that actually, you just feel a bit shit when you do it. You don't like it, it demotivates you. They might even get a tutor and spend money so that you build that up. Which is, and you know, the strength philosophy is saying, whilst that's really well intended, it's kind of misguided. And actually we need to flip up its head and say, what do you do really well in? What do you enjoy? How do we give you more time to do that? Because actually if you're average at something and you work on it, absolutely you can improve and it prevents failure. But if you're already great at something and you have a natural talent and you add to that, that's what's going to lead to excellence. So Marcus Buckingham, one of the co-founders of the strengths philosophy, and a quote we use a lot, says that people don't actually change that much, so don't waste time putting in what was left out. Try to draw out what's left in, as that's already hard enough. And the reason why the strengths philosophy is kind of so important, and why I'm talking about it now, why I believe it links to mental health at work, is, again, Gallup, an organisation that are kind of responsible for putting this into the workplace. They say that actually if you focus on your strengths, you're 6 times more engaged at work. And the best stat that I ever get to share whenever I'm presenting to our people is that actually if you have a focus on strengths, you're 3 times more likely to report having an excellent quality of life in general. And that is a pretty bold statement. But if you think you're always working on something that you're not that great at, you're always getting quite bad feedback about it, you're always being asked to work on something that drains you or demotivates you, you are not going to have as good a quality of life as if you focus on something that energizes you, that you're naturally drawn to, you get that positive feedback on. So it's not to say that we ask our people to ignore their weaknesses. It's not to say that people can't grow and learn new skills and new knowledge, but it's just saying each of us has growth potential for success in specific areas, and therefore we want them to focus on their strengths. So aside from these stats, focusing on strengths, a lot of other positive interactions there as well. And how tangibly this works within Red Bull, because I know we can talk about these philosophies, but what does it look like in terms of what we actually do? And when someone starts with Red Bull, they get sent a code on their first day. And that is a code to the Gallup StrengthsFinder. I don't know if any of you are familiar with it, but it's kind of a psychometric assessment that identifies what your natural talents are. So through a concept called like neuroplasticity, which is how your brain's kind of naturally wired to those talents. And there's actually a 1 in 34 million chance of you having the same kind of talent description as someone else. Someone gets this report, looks through it, their manager will then follow up within the first week, catch up with them, and go through what their talents are, whether people see it, whether it resonates with them, how they think they can use it at work. And then within their first 3 months, they come into the office, they'll meet with the leadership team for breakfast, and then they'll attend a strengths workshop, which explains the strengths philosophies, what it is, why we use it, and how they can use it at Red Bull, how they can use it in terms of their objective setting, how they can use it in conversations with their managers and team. And then when people have been here a little while longer, we also make sure that not just the manager's responsibility, but the employees ask for a strengths discussion guide, which is just how they can work on their strengths a little bit more and how people can work together and understand kind of their true motivations and why as well. And then our objectives are set around absolutely company objectives, absolutely role objectives, but a third of it is based around the outputs of these strengths discussion guides and actually what it is that motivates you and where you feel you can get your best performance. And then finally, once the objectives are set, we focus on strengths-based development plans. So, you know, what are your natural talents? How do you add skills and knowledge to make that strength? Absolutely, if something is a weakness, so it gets in the way of theirs or someone else's success, part of development as well. But we just really want to emphasize that strengths focus. And then in terms of our UK values, so these are kind of not values that we decided, they're values that our people told us that they want to kind of adhere by, live by, and exude, and they believe fits in with Red Bull. So we'd already always had some global values, and 3 years ago we asked our team, what do you think it is about working here that you want to kind of commit to from a value base? And they came up with these. So they want to be themselves, they don't want to bend themselves out of shape to fit in at work. And then from that comes from enjoying what you do, knowing and managing your strengths, getting involved, and I'm running out of time, so I'll shoot through them. Going beyond, which is all about the growth mindset piece, we did a lot of work on Carol Dweck's work with the growth mindset. You guys are familiar with that. And we believe that at Red Bull, we really push the boundaries and we go beyond, and we need to look at how we do that each and every day with our people. And then also open and honest as well, not just in terms of feedback, but being open and honest about how you feel and what it is you need. So a lot of our wellbeing inputs sit under this Be Yourself focus. So other than the strengths focus, we offer a number of different wellbeing sessions. So how do you thrive at work? How do you ensure you don't get stressed? Moments that matter. So if you're a parent or a carer and you're a full-time worker, how do you create those experiences, moments outside of work, as well as kind of mental health first aid. And then also the Sanctus coaching. So when I first met with George, I think a lot of their values really align to us, like being yourself more, being open and honest in the workplace, like absolutely identifies with our values and what it is we do. And when we put this in, I kind of call it the Glastonbury of well-being, because the Sanctus sessions literally sell out within like 10 minutes and book out. So for anyone who's kind of thinking about using Sanctus, I think we need to kind of let our people decide. It's amazing how popular it is and how many people are talking about it in the workplace as well. So, you know, just anecdotal feedback that actually by talking about Sanctus session, or have you been to a Sanctus session, or, you know, what is it you talked about? People are starting to speak a lot more about how they feel or things they wouldn't usually speak about. So we're also going to look at how we then, we realise we've had a big well-being focus kind of this year, and a lot of our new people coming in need to know it as well. So we're going to look towards how we can actually onboard our people and our managers in terms of what our approach is, and also, you know, what we're doing to support it. And I think the well-being sessions have been fantastic and well received. Sanctus has been absolutely fantastic, and people have really bought into the mental health pledge. But I honestly think what makes the difference in well-being at work and people being happy at work is what we do every day to engage our people, and all part of our philosophies. And actually, it's only when people need slightly more help or they might have things outside of work going on that those well-being sessions then really land and work. So I wouldn't be from Red Bull if I didn't finish off with a video. So I am going to close with a video. But just what I really want the video to demonstrate is just exactly what you can achieve if you do go beyond. But not only that, sometimes we have some limits, we have barriers in our organisation. We alluded to it in the last Q&A, and just really what we can achieve if we remove those barriers and, you know, change those kind of limits we think we have. So